You are the reason, oh Lord, all the reason we even have breath on this earth. It's all because of you. Oh, and I belong to you. So much strength comes from that fact, oh Lord, that I belong to you, God, that I belong to you.
Opportunity to corporately gather and lift your name and praise your name and worship you and exalt you, Lord. We just walk in here, Lord, and we yield ourselves to you fresh. Want you to have your way in our lives, Lord. So Jesus, we just take your yoke. We take your yoke, oh Jesus. Walking with you, Lord. Find in your heart, Lord. Teach us your ways, Lord. Teach us your ways, God. Thank you, Jesus.
Calling.
seat of authority. Heavenly places, heavenly places.
Yeah. Majestical God, it is who you are, Lord. You shine, Lord, like the sun, God. You shimmer, you reflect every piece of who you are, God, every facet of your brilliance, God. And we can come close and see it in full view, God, if we just incline ourselves to you, God. So, Father, thank you for this morning, Lord. Thank you for letting us incline ourselves. Incline ourselves to you, God, to see you in all your glory, Lord, and all your majesty, Father. To you alone, God, to you we lift up our voices, God. To you alone, Lord, we'll set our passion before you, God. To you alone, Lord, we'll set our hearts on fire for you, Lord. Our love ablaze, God, for you alone, King of Kings and Lord of Lords. We bless you, your holy, holy name, God. Your holy name, the name above every other name, O God. Yes. We revere you, O King. We revere you, O God. We love you, Lord. Thank you for your presence, God, this morning. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Morning. You can have a seat. If you don't know, my name is Alden Anderson, and I'm going to help us transition into the next portion of this service. Presence is amazing, right? Amen. So just a few things coming up this week. This evening, we have, as always, our GTU experience, our GT encounter service. Woo-hoo. So please, please, there's only two left. And the one and only beautiful and wonderful Pastor Jane is preaching tonight. So please come out and check it out. Like I said, it's one of the last two before school starts. So on that note, the deadline for applications has come and gone. However, we are still accepting GTU applications. We're doing interviews like crazy. So if you are still interested, there's still time. School starts September 7th. So you will want to make sure that you get stuff in order by then. If you have questions, please see Sean, Kelly, or myself. And we will be happy to assist you. But please come out tonight. Last two before the school starts. Also, coming up very soon, in about a month, kids check-in center is going to be changing a little bit. The classrooms are going to be adjusting a little bit. We're going to have a little bit different security things now. So just parents, be aware that in the coming weeks, you'll want to plan out a little extra time to bring your wonderful munchkins in so we can get them checked in appropriately. Lastly, this Friday night, how many of you love the worship right here? All the time, like between the morning services, the night services, you know, being a worship leader, sometimes you get excited because you just get a little drunk in the presence, right? But okay, so if you want more of that, you need to come out this Friday night to Fireflies. Okay, it's open. Sean started it, but it's really open to anyone who wants to come. He started it with the teens and the young adults, but really anyone can come. We've had many people of all ages. So please, it starts at 10 p.m. right here. I know all y'all said it's too late. It's not too late because we go all night. So you can just, you know, take a little nap and then you come at 10 and then you stay for however long you want. So from 10 p.m. to 6 a.m. Friday into Saturday. Y'all know you got to get a little spunky going on up in some of the, you know, you haven't done a little crazy overnighter in a while. You know you got to come for it. So so come out Friday night. Can I have the ushers come forward, please? We're going to receive the offering this morning. The tithe unto the Lord. So, Father, we thank you, God. Lord, we just humble ourselves, God, in this moment. God, I thank you that you've given us the privilege to give you the first 10%, God. That is a privilege and it's an honor, God, for your kingdom and for your glory, Lord. So, Father, we ask that this morning you would bless it, Lord. You would bless every penny that comes in, God, for your kingdom, for your glory, God. That you would shine forth, God, in this place and in this community, God. We ask you to bless it and multiply it today, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Make his praise glorious, 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 for his name is glorious, glorious, glorious. Oh, make his praise glorious, glorious. His name, glorious, he is glorious, glorious. To our God we lift up one voice, to our God we lift up one song, to our God we lift up one voice, singing hallelujah. To our God we lift up one voice, to our God we lift up one song, to our God we lift up one voice, singing hallelujah, hallelujah, singing hallelujah, hallelujah, singing hallelujah.
Cute. It's just really, really just good to be with our family this morning and to enjoy Dad. Thank you for our friends, our visitors from Kenya this morning. We're glad to have you guys with us. Paul and Chris, you're back home after, just a bit of time over there serving. Good to have you guys there. I'm sure we're going to hear many stories. There'll be many videotaping sessions. Welcome home. You guys were missed, prayed for, loved, and we're excited to hear what all that God has done the last few weeks. We had a few things going on here while you guys were gone. Dale Baggerly tells us that there were 3,800 plus kids through the door at iMatter this year, and You know, I just love that God has entrusted a generation to us. He doesn't take this generation lightly. I want to just talk with you this morning, because I want to align some things this morning. I want to be faithful to really, every week, I'm going to really try to have us really get to know God better. How many think if you're going to come to church, we probably ought to get to know God better? That would be a good goal for every church service, you'll know him a little bit better. And how many know that you get to know somebody better by spending time with them? That's why if we're coming to church, you know, if he's not here, let's just watch the Giants. We don't want to watch Dallas because... because we're not in Texas. Thank you. That's nice and cold, too. Hi, Jake.
Yeah, yeah.
Good morning.
Hello.
I love you, man. You can't have my water.
Oh, no.
Yeah, I know. I think he said he loves me, too. I was blessed by what took place, and there's so many reports, hundreds of reports from kids that had an encounter with God and just had a great time. And I know a lot of you have been sharing, you know, what an amazing weekend last weekend was. But how many know that God wants us to go from glory to glory? Last weekend was just a beginning to a life that he has planned for us. And how many know that those kids last weekend was a beginning for the life that he has planned for them, right? And I wanted to talk this morning, and I want to just ask a few questions. I want to start by doing some alignment things first. How do you know when somebody is operating under the right spirit? I'm just going to ask a few questions. How many know that we all operate under a spirit? Sometimes it's the Holy Spirit. If it's not the Holy Spirit, I have to ask you what spirit it is. See, I just really believe that we either are for Christ or we are against him. Yes? If you're not operating underneath the influence of the Holy Spirit, then the other spirit that you're operating under is an anti-Christ spirit. There's no, like, well, this is an okay spirit. And there's no okay spirit if it's not a Christ spirit. So so if you take a spirit and then you take an attitude, you can say, I either have a Christ attitude or I have an anti-Christ attitude. I either have a Christ thought or I have an anti-Christ thought. It really is that simple. Okay? So let me just give you some for instances. I'm just gonna, and you guys tell me whether it's a Christ spirit or an anti-Christ spirit. If you find the best in people, what spirit is that? If you look for the worst in people, what spirit is that? If you speak life over somebody, what spirit is that? If you speak death over somebody, what spirit is that? There are two kinds of people in this world. They're those people that are doing things for the kingdom of God. And there's those that are critiquing what the people are doing for the kingdom of God. Which spirit is of Christ? The ones doing for the kingdom of God or the ones critiquing the kingdom of God? Okay. I just want to make sure that we understand that I had a number of good people. How many know that good people can be under the influence of the wrong spirit and therefore do bad things? They're not bad people. They're just good people on hearing the wrong voice, doing the wrong things. Okay, so I had some people, great people, come and, you know, hey, how was I matter? Man, it was great. You know, these kids encountered the love of God. There's people, I had testimony after testimony of those that gave their life to Jesus Christ. Most negative thing I heard from the kids was that they didn't really like the dust. But everything else, I heard testimony after testimony of the miracles that were happening in the fields. There was one boy who broke his leg. The bone is sticking out. People prayed for it. By the time he got to the hospital, there was no pain. The x-rays showed there was no break at all. He was back at iMatter. Took an ambulance to the hospital, and then Jillian brought him back. So all these beautiful things happening, and people's lives being changed, encountering unconditional love. not just from the people on the stage. The bands encountered it. Concessions people demonstrated it. Merch people demonstrated it. Our security team demonstrated it. All these people are engaging, and powerful things are happening over the field. For those of you who are there, you know what I'm talking about. The ground was good. So I had somebody come and say, well, that's all good, Pastor Scott. That's all good. But what's your follow-up program? And I asked them a simple question. See, when you know Jesus, you always have a response to a satanic accusation. Now, that's not a bad thing to have a follow-up program. But when you know Jesus, you know what the follow-up program is. It's called the Holy Spirit. See, I read Scripture and I read all the Gospels, and I don't see ever that Jesus ever had a follow-up program. The follow-up program was they had an encounter with the risen Lord, and their lives were changed forever. And what did they do? They pursued him. See, religion needs a follow-up program because nothing powerful happens. If you have a program, then you need a process which needs paperwork. But if you have an encounter, what happens is the person who has an encounter has a heart change, and they pursue the one that they had an encounter with. I promise you, gentlemen, when you fell in love with that woman, she did not have to have a follow-up program to have you call her. So I encourage these young ones, instead of asking what actually happened, show up next time and make it happen. They became very quiet. Can I just say this? Listen, there's three leavens that are working in our culture. There's a government leaven, which is a humanist point of view that says, I'm all right with God as long as he doesn't interfere with my life. There is a religious leaven that says, I'm all right with Jesus, I'm all right with the Holy Spirit, I'm all right with God as long as he's not powerful and cost me something. But the kingdom demands that we preach a gospel that actually is Jesus. And see, there's three leavens at work. I've been involved with all three, and I want to tell you, I like it on this side of the kingdom way better than I did in religion and way better than I did in government spirits influencing me. I was a very critical person when I was under the influence of governmental because it was all about me. And when I was under the religious spirit, I was very critical because nothing could ever be good enough. See, because religious people and governmental people, they walk in fear, not faith. See, I'm never worried about what you're doing for the kingdom. Now, I'm going to name some names today because I love all these guys. But Bobby Russell down at Horseheads Community this morning. He's going to be preaching. I am not afraid at all that he might make a mistake. Not at all. Why? Mike Spencer is going to be preaching this morning, right down here at his tab. I am not worried at all that he's going to make a mistake. Now, I'm going to tell you that he is going to. I'm going to tell you that Bobby Russell is going to. And most every church, every church that has anybody human speaking from the pulpit is going to make mistakes this morning. See, fear demands perfection. Faith demands a heart that hears from God and is willing to risk and speak on his behalf. How many know we see in part? We prophesy in part. See, the problem with religious spirits is they only want to see the part that's wrong. They don't want to hear the God that's in the good part. See, but people of the kingdom find God in everything, while people in religion find God in nothing. They make excuses. And so I just want to encourage you, man, it's like we don't have to live in those other kingdoms. We can live in the kingdom, which is a kingdom that has no end. And it goes from glory to glory to glory, from faith to faith to faith. Let me see. Brian, what's your favorite color? Why? Nobody told you that green was your favorite color? You didn't read it in the Bible? Why is green your favorite color? Is it possible that he put something inside of you that desires green? Bill, what's your favorite color? You're just copying Brian, man. You're blue. You're okay. You're blue and you lied. Let me just throw this out there. Why is it that, you're blue and you're green. Who's right? Okay, Pastor Brian's right. Is it possible that God put the desire for blue and for green in two different individuals because they're unique? Do you know that Brian can make an argument for green and that what's your name again? That Bill can make an argument for blue. Why? Because it's their preference. Because there's something inside of them that they desire green more than they do blue, and blue more than they do green. Can I just tell you something? How many believe that God wants to answer the desires of your heart? Do you know why? Because he put them there. He gives you the desires of your heart, and that's twofold. He gives you your desires, so therefore, because he gives you your desires, he wants to give you your desires. So desires are not a bad thing. We've told people to stop dreaming, stop imagining, stop being creative. Why? Because we gotta squelch those desires down. No, you do not. What you have to do is you have to prioritize your desires. Yeah. And when he becomes your first and only desire, then all your other desires get fulfilled. But he wants to answer those as a good father. He's a good father. You know that. You know that. He's a good father. Brian, give me a thought in your head that you're struggling with. I'm going to use both of you, so you can start thinking about it, Bill. Give me a thought in your head that you're struggling with the gospel, or about yourself, or about somebody else. Give me a thought that you're struggling with. I said one yesterday that I was struggling with regard to unbelief and hope rather than faith. Remember that? Give me one. Worthiness. Okay, so when you hear, I'm going to teach you guys, how many want to know how to know God's voice? I'm going to teach you today how to know God's voice. Simple, little, easy lesson. Brian, you are not worthy. Whose voice is that? The problem is when we believe a lie, it becomes very powerful in our life. How did he know that that was from the enemy? Because a good father would never call his son unworthy. Are you hearing me? Bill? What's a thought that you have that you struggle with about somebody else, yourself? Not about me. I don't want to hear anything about me. Just being faithful every minute. So, as a father, do you think that the father is looking at you and waiting for you to become unfaithful? Never. But yet we walk in this place of guilt and shame and condemnation because we allow the one who is the liar to speak more truth into our life. How many know that the liar actually does speak truth? Because he uses the word. Why? Listen, ready for this? The Bible says to rightly divide the truth. Why would you have to divide the truth? It's truth. How many know that there can be truth and there can be a higher truth? How many know that God always wants you to take you to the higher truth, not hold you to a truth? How many know that the law is truth? The law is truth. How many know that grace is a higher truth? What does he hold us to? He holds us to the truth that is what? Rightly divided. Show yourself approved. And in that passage, I think it's in Galatians, it may be in Ephesians, it's one of those. What he's talking about in rightly dividing the truth is the fact of stop gossiping and stop arguing over everything. Because a whole bunch of people are looking at you. Watch this. Brian, tell me something of heresy. Just speak something heresy over me.
I don't think
it's right. You don't know any heresy? Come on. I got one for you. I got one for you. I'm in heresy all the time, so let me help you this. Scott, if you don't do this, then shame on you. But see, when I know the truth, you can't speak shame on me. So what do I say to Brian? Hey, Brian, hey, whatever works for you, bro. But what? I'm not afraid of what Brian, whichever spirit you're under. I am never afraid of what somebody speaks over my life anymore because I have lost the fear of man. When people come up to me now and they say, "Well, Pastor Scott, we're concerned. We're concerned. Really, you're concerned? How come you're only concerned about what the Bible says when it's about somebody else rather than about yourself? How come you always want to use the Bible as a weapon, but I don't see anything of the Bible producing actually fruit in your life?" So here's what I mean by that. God is love. And they will know that we are Christians by our critique. By how well we know doctrine. By how many scriptures we memorized. They will know we are Christians by our love. And somebody said to me, "Well, Pastor Scott, I don't hear good doctrine out of you." And I said, "Well, I don't know any doctrine that could be good without love being at the root of it." I hear it a lot of times, "Pastor Scott, it's like, you know, I hear this love message from you, and you just love." And I had a whole lot of people from the Christian side of Facebook, I call it. The world loves to be loved. The world loves to have hope. In fact, the desires of the nations is Jesus Christ. But the church wants a preached message, not a lived message. See, the church is saying, "Yeah, we heard a lot of false hope at iMatter this year. A lot of false hope. But the gospel message should have been preached." And so how I responded to my friends was this. I said, "Well, the gospel message was actually more than preached. The gospel message was demonstrated." And see, what we have now is we have a whole generation. See, the Bible says not just to disciple one. It says to disciple nations. But the church is looking for immediate gratifications, and they want to do the checkbox, and they want to make sure that they've covered the bases and that they've got the program in place and that follow-up has happened. Why? Because they're afraid that they haven't met the mark. All God wants is this. He says everything hangs on this. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, and mind, and love each other. See, if we love people, it allows the Holy Spirit to do what he's supposed to do, and that's convict people. You know, it's amazing. I have never, ever had to point out when somebody's doing wrong. How many of you know when you've done wrong? See, but what people always struggle with is how to make it right. See, that's the purpose of the Holy Spirit. He wants to take us into a place of right standing and of right ground and of righteousness. Conviction brings you towards the Lord. Condemnation pushes you away from him. Okay, that was my intro. Now I've got... Want to get into the word now? Everybody got a little better perspective? Everybody know how to hear God now better? I know. See, when it's hopeful, when it's encouragement, when it's lovely, when it's pure, when it's of a good report, how many know that somebody comes to you and every... Okay, let me... I'm going to use one more example. Bill's my friend. Brian's my friend. Now, this is just an example. This doesn't happen. But every time I get with Bill, Bill has something critical and negative to say about Brian. "Did you see that striped shirt that Brian wore on Sunday? He should never wear horizontal lines." No, that's what Bill said, dude. I didn't say that. I'm saying what Bill said. So then I get with Brian, and Brian, like every time I get with Brian, like, "You know, man, I adore Bill. I love to see the love of Jesus in his eyes. You know, every time Bill opens his mouth, I hear the Lord coming out." And I'm thinking, "You have no idea. You have no idea what Bill's been saying, you know? But let me just ask you something. They're both my friends. Who should I come into agreement with?" You guys don't know? Really? Let me just tell you something. If you're getting with people and all they do is bash your pastor every time you're with them, you might want to consider not hanging out with them. Listen, if every time you get with somebody and they bash your wife, what would you do? If every time you get with someone and they bash your Jesus, What would you do? Now listen, that doesn't mean, here, listen, there's some people that we sit with, there's some people that we stand with, and there's some people that we walk with and we do life. I would let you consider something right now. People that want to bring other people down, don't walk with them in life. You can sit down and have fellowship with them trying to bring them out. You can maybe stand with them in a crisis, but don't spend your life with those kind of people. Just straight up. Now I can love Bill in his critical spirit of Brian, and I can love Brian in his great words of Bill towards Bill, but the bottom line is this whole deal is that I can't expose myself to a critical spirit, to a negative tone, to an accusation towards somebody else all the time, because love says that that doesn't do that. Let me tell you what love does. Turn to 1 Corinthians 13. I wasn't going to go here, but I'm going to now because I can. Until Polly shuts my microphone off. And still let you hear me. You muted me, didn't you? I'm going to come back and slap your bald head. 1 Corinthians 13 says, though I speak with the tongues of men and of angels, but I have not what? Love. I've become sounding brass and clanging cymbals. You're noise. Listen, when you hear people speaking to you out of any other language except for love, it's white noise. I'm going to tell you something. I'm all about filters. I'm all about filters. But no filter can filter out white noise. So anybody speaking into your life that are speaking without love, you can't have a strong enough filter. Consider that. If you're around people that are acting constantly out of love, we're going to talk about bondage today. How many know a lot of amazing Christians that are in bondage? We're going to talk about that today. And though I have the gift of prophecy and understand all mysteries and all knowledge, and through all I have all this faith, and I have this great doctrine, and I could remove mountains, but I don't have love, I am what? Nothing. You think love's important to God? Then why would we dare say to somebody, man, you're just speaking too much about love? Can you speak too much about love? Can you demonstrate too much love? Not if God is love. What is love? Watch this. Starting with verse 4. This is what love looks like. Love suffers long and is kind. Pastor Scott, you don't know what I'm going through. That's just what love does. Pastor Scott, you're asking me to be kind in the midst of the... That's just what love does. Love doesn't envy. You know, when somebody has a success or they've got a house or they've got this, can I tell you, don't be jealous of them. Be jealous for them. Love does not parade itself and puffed up. Well, I've got the real word of the Lord. Anytime you hear that, understand this. They have no word of the Lord. Zero. Anybody who has to tell you that they are something, that means they're nothing. Nobody who is a leader has to tell you, well, I'm a leader. Nobody who is a prophet has to tell you they're a prophet. They're not a prophet. If they have to tell you who they are. If people are telling you, yeah, I'm a Christian. Oh, I couldn't tell. I love God. Really? I've never seen that in you. I love people. Wow. That's love. I don't want to have any of it. Love suffers as long as kind. Love does not envy. Love does not parade around. Does not behave rudely. I'm still working on that one. Does not seek its own. Is not provoked. It doesn't think evil. How many people know if you're not thinking evil, if you're not looking for evil, you're not finding evil? Can I just propose this to you? That which you focus on is what you'll find. If you look for the good in people and you focus on the good in people, that's what's going to come forth and that's what's going to grow. Your opinion of a church, your opinion of leadership, your opinion, you know, this is not political, but I'm going to use this as an example. I'm not a Democrat, okay? I'm registered Republican, but I'm actually a Christian. What I do is whoever, see, because I actually believe when the word says that God puts people into leadership, he raises them up, you know? I vote my convictions that are by the Holy Spirit. I try to live that way. But whoever is in power, I have come to the point that I pray for them. See, when I'm praying for someone, it's hard to hate somebody that you're praying for. It's hard to speak ill of somebody that you're praying for. You see, my prayer always is that if we have an evil leader, that the resources at which they're making decisions from actually get transported to a heavenly resource rather than an earthly one. Ouch, that hurts, don't it? Now this is fairly new for me because I used to join in the reindeer games. And this may be very political, you know, to some. It's not political to me at all. It's the fact of every single person, Democrat or Republican, we're not even in an election year. I don't know. Whatever. But they were created by God in his image. Okay? And our goal is you see what I'm saying? Now, that doesn't mean that they're right or wrong. It doesn't mean, they can be absolutely wrong. I Hitler, probably I would have had a difficult time praying for the man. You know, when you look at a person and you see that they were once a baby and that they were a child, okay, and you see, I just feel like the church is being called to be a voice of reason, to change culture. Let me get it off the political because I'm aggravating a whole bunch of people. So, and Lord knows, I love doing that. I went into Wink 106 on Friday. They invited me to come in, and what they're going to do is they're going to allow me to be speaking on three different radio stations. One is this AM station called 820, and I'm going to be right in between Sean Hannity and Rush Limbaugh. Yay. And then I'm going to be on Wink 106 with a whole bunch of demographics of everyone, they tell me. Like, everybody listens to Wink 106. And then I'm going to be on some country station. I don't know what country the music's from, but we're going to be on that country station. We got all done, and he's working all this. He goes, Scott, and I said, where do I go as far as my faith and my Christianity? He goes, I trust you. You tell him your story. No restrictions. And so in September, October, every week or every other week, I'll be having segments where kids call into Wink 106 and talk to me about life decisions. That just happened this year. So that's really cool. Okay, so that's really, but this is the coolest part. This is the coolest part is that, they don't have to see my face because I'll be on radio. No, that's not. That's not cool. At the end of that conversation, Andrew, I don't know where Andrew is, but he was with me. There's Andrew back there on the camera. Andrew was with me, and we're talking with the general manager of all of these stations around the region, and he's all dressed in a suit and tie and looking sharp, and I'm in shorts and a T-shirt. And I didn't know he was going to be dressed that way, and because we've met before, and he wasn't dressed that way. He was dressed that way. Big. All these bigwigs were in there for that day, and his staff are all there. DJs are all there, and God tells me. Okay, for those of you who don't know that God speaks to you, God put an impression on me. Is that safer? Does that feel better? Okay. He said, I want you to hug this man and pray for him. I'm going, ain't happening. Not going there, not doing it. No. So I get up and I said, okay, I'll pray for him. I gave him that. I'll just say a quick word, you know. And I go, Smitty, I said, is it all right if I, and he goes, you want to hug me, don't you? Didn't he, Andrew, right? You want to hug me, don't you? Are you kidding me right now? So I threw my arms around him. You know, I'm in my shorts. He's in a three-piece suit, just being the executive. I threw my arms around him, and he embraced me and broke while I prayed life over him. He's not a believer. And when we got done, he said, amen. How much do you have to believe before you're actually a believer is my question. I didn't go into the Trinity. I didn't go into the doctrines. I didn't go into, what did I do? I love the man. And it broke down every stinking wall he popped. I don't know if this guy's ever been hugged. Certainly not by clients. God knows what he's doing, y'all. Love never fails. A lot of things will fail. A lot of things. Faith will fail. Doctrine will fail. Preaching will fail. Hope will fail. Love will never fail. It's 10 o'clock. I still got 15 minutes. All right, I'm going to preach you my message now. Is that all right? Can I do that now? Everybody feeling all right? Everybody good? Yeah, no? Anybody hungry for a bagel? Okay. We got those right after this. We might even have pizza. I don't know. I'm a pretty risky guy. I've been told that I'm a friend of sinners. I've been told that I'm influenced by demons. I'm called a liar. Loving every minute of it. Mm-hmm. The reason is this, that I can say that now. I can say that now because when you absolutely know that you're pleasing the Father's heart and he's singing over your life, then man's opinion loses its sting. How many know that Jesus did a few things that demanded a response from people that gave them their opinions that sounded similar to ones I just said about me? Do you know that Jesus was told that everything he did by some people, they said, you do this because of the influence of demons. You do this because you're under the influence of the devil. In fact, they called him a devil. They called him Beelzebub. This is one thing I do know about Jesus, that he brings freedom to those that are captives. He binds up the brokenhearted. He raises the dead. He heals the sick, right? He delivers people from demons. And everybody who doesn't do that don't like him. Everybody. Anybody who wasn't of that same mind. See, let's make this legal. Let's make this legal. Let's get into the word, all right? Turn with me in your Bibles to John chapter 8. John chapter 8. Because a lot of people think that once you're saved, that the finished work of Christ is all you need. Uh-oh. That might scare somebody. How many know that Christ's work is absolutely finished? Done. How many know that we work from a place of victory, not for victory? Okay, that's been done, all right? The problem is that we have a whole bunch of people that think that what Jesus did, he did as God. And because he did it as God and we're not, that means that we don't have to do it. Was Jesus our example? Are we supposed to do what Jesus did? God bless you. Five demons all at once. That's amazing. I think there's a lot of people who think that because they're saved, that they are free of any responsibility to see the finished work finished in them. How many know if there was anybody sick in this room right now and Jesus was here, that there wouldn't be anybody sick in this room when we left today? We all believe that. How many really believe that there's nothing that God can't do? I mean, we really do believe that. So then what is it that we don't believe? As believers, what is it that we don't believe? that we can do it too. And see, there's a lie that the enemy has put in us. And there's a doctrine out there. A lot of churches carry this doctrine. I would say 90-some percent of churches carry this doctrine. That what Jesus did was only for Jesus. And then, they have a hard time with that, defending that. So they go, well, it was the apostles, and it was to prove that the apostles were who the apostles were. So then they have a hard time defending that when it says that those who believe that these signs and wonders will follow them. See, sometimes demons can speak the word of God as well. I think that's Paul back there, isn't it? He just can't figure it out. Here she comes to save the day. Oh. Yes. That's a good word right there. All right, let's do this. Let's do this. Verse 30. As he spoke these words, many believed him. Now, ready? Many believed him. He's got the same audience in front of him that he's now going to speak the next words to. How many know that the people that he's speaking to, many of them are believers now? Okay, set the tone. He's speaking to believers here. Then Jesus said to those Jews who believed him, believers, Jews who believed him, if you abide in my word, you are my disciples indeed. Now, how many know that the Jews knew Scripture inside and out? In fact, they memorized it since birth. From the time they could read, they knew Scripture. But Jesus is saying to them, if you abide in my word, I just want to tell you something. I want to just have you consider that reading the word and abiding in the word are two different things. There's a lot of people that want to use the word as a defense and use the word. I checked it off today. It's not about that. It's abiding in the word. How many know that when Jesus spoke in the synagogue, he spoke out of the word? All right? How many know when we spoke out of the synagogue, he didn't? I'm talking about this. When he spoke, you've heard it said, the word said this, but I say this. How many know that Jesus actually is the word? Okay, well, stay with me. And you shall know the truth. He's speaking to the Jews here who are believers. Jews who are believers. You shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. Well, if they're believers, aren't they already free? Okay, watch this. They answered him, we are Abraham's descendants, duh, and have never been in bondage to anyone. All right, ready? The Jews were in bondage to everyone at some time or another. And when they made this statement, they were in bondage to Rome. We've never been in bondage to anyone. How many know there's a lot of people in the church that have no idea that they're in bondage? I said, dude, you're in bondage. No, I'm just struggling. Well, how long have you been struggling? 30 years. I'm just having a moment. How many moments? Oh, about 20 years worth of moments. They answered him, we are Abraham's descendants. We have bondage. How can you say that you will be made free? Jesus answered them, most assuredly I say to you that whoever commits sin is enslaved to sin. Can I ask you something? What do you think that word commit means? I looked it up. It means prolonged. How do you know if you are in bondage to something? Let me give you one word. Chronic. Let me just set you free of something. You make a mistake, you're not in bondage to it. That's what repentance is for, is to get up and go on. Just close that chapter, go on. It's not bondage. But where it's chronic, where you just stay there, it's prolonged, you just stay there. Stay with me. See, it says this. Most assuredly, I say to you, whoever commits or in a prolonged sin is a slave to sin, and a slave does not abide in the house forever. How many know that if you're in bondage to something, you're not going to be in the house forever? But Pastor Scott, I'm saved. I'm just giving you Jesus' words. He says this. He says, but a son will abide forever. All the creation is waiting for the sons and daughters of God to be revealed. Why? Because he doesn't want us as slaves. Because a son and daughter actually knows the heart of their father. A slave does not. Now, you and I know that when we first come into the kingdom, we're slaves, we're bond servants of Jesus Christ. But he does not want us to stay there. Why? Because slaves don't know his heart. All right? Everybody good? So we want, there's a truth, right? We were sinners saved by grace. The higher truth is we're sons and daughters of the Most High God. Don't stay at this truth when he's calling you up to a higher truth. And see, the problem is a lot of us, now that we've tasted of the higher truth, we can't go back to slavery. Whatever, okay, therefore, if the Son makes you free, you shall be free indeed. I know that you are Abraham's descendants, but you seek to kill me because my word, wait a minute, they studied the word all the time. But he said, my word has no place in you. People can read the word, study the word, and never even hear the word. I speak what I have seen with my father, and you do what you have seen with your father. They answered and said to him, Abraham is our father. Jesus said to them, if you were Abraham's children, you would do the works that Abraham did. Can I just tell you something? You'll know who's their father by how they act. When you start accusing other people, guess who's your father? You can read on with this. You can read on with this. If you're in a state of fear, if you're in a state of confusion, if you're always walking in doubt, if you're always walking in this thing of afraid of making mistakes, if you're looking at other people and trying to find what's wrong in them, if you're always critical, if you're walking in offense, he's not your father. I'm talking about chronic, where it's just chronic. Man, get out of it. Be free. If you're free in Jesus, you're free indeed. Be free from it. Sin no longer has dominion over you. Go to Jeremiah 7 real quick. Jeremiah 7, 8 through 11. It says this, behold, you trust in lying words that cannot profit. Listen. Will you steal? Will you murder? Will you commit adultery? Will you swear falsely? Will you burn incense to Baal and walk after other gods whom you do not know? And then come in here and stand before me in my house, in my church, in my temple, in this place. Will you come in here and stand in here after serving and chasing after all these other gods, stealing from people, lacking integrity, and you're going to come in here and you're going to be stand before the living God and you're going to think that because, watch this, and then come and stand before me in this house, which is called by my name, and say, we are delivered to do all of these abominations. I want to tell you something. He sets you free to be delivered from those things that you're not supposed to be doing, yet you think because you've been set free that you can still keep doing the same things you used to do, and you still serve other gods and other idols, and you serve other lords. Why? Because you have to consult with them before you do anything with God. Whatever you have to consult with before you say yes to God, that's your God. Well, let me check my work schedule. Lord tells you to give $1,000. Let me see if it fits into my budget. Can I just tell you something? God may ask you to give everything that, and everything doesn't fit in your budget. What if he asks for your time? I don't know if I have time. Are you tracking with me? I think John Wesley said it this way, I will never, ever, ever, leisure will never find its place in me again. How much does leisure benefit us? I'm not saying leisure is bad. You know why I'm not saying it? Because I'm going on vacation this afternoon. Leisure's not bad. But if I have to consult and see, here, listen, if God told Lisa and I to stay here for the next 2 weeks, leisure, vacation would not dictate. Oh, well, we made a commitment. We did the hotel reservation. You know how many times we've canceled airline? I'm not praising us. I'm just saying. We've set up airline tickets, paid for airline tickets, and three times when God said, no, I don't want you to go. All of them have been pleasurable things that we were going to go to. You go, mm-mm, don't want you to go. See, he's just looking for us to be in that place that he gets the first order of business, And I promise you, Lisa and I do not lack in accomplishing fun times. We don't lack in doing things that we enjoy. They're just not first. They're just not more important than him or you. How many know that have been around my life? Andrew's been around my life a little bit recently, and those of you who hang out with me a little bit know that as best as I can, him and you come first. Is that a right spirit or a wrong spirit? Okay, but it's not just for me. The Bible says this, consider others before you do yourself. See, I think that's actually a fruit of the Spirit. How many know that one of the fruits of the Spirit is love and kindness and gentleness and right, meekness? Turn over to Romans 6, 15 and 16. I'm done. Huh, how do you like that? Okay, you guys pretend like I'm done. Romans 6, I really am almost done. I'm going to give you 3 points. Stand up there and give you 3 points. Let me finish with this. Romans 6. What did I say? Romans 6 what? Huh? 15, 16, 17, somewhere on there? What then? Shall we sin because we are not under law but under grace? Certainly not. Do you not know that to whom you present yourselves slaves to obey, you are the ones slaves whom you obey, whether of sin leading to death or of obedience leading to righteousness? But God be thanked that though you were slaves, and ready? Though you were, say that with me, though you were slaves to sin. How many know you are no longer slaves to sin? How many know that sin is no longer the issue in your life, but righteousness is? You don't struggle with sin. You struggle with a lack of righteousness. How many know Sodom and Gomorrah didn't get wiped out because of sin. Sodom and Gomorrah got wiped out because of lack of righteousness. Because if they could have found 10 righteous people, God would not have wiped out Sodom and Gomorrah. How many know the wages of sin is death? You can work for sin and get what you want, which is death. Or you can actually have the gift of God, which is eternal life through Jesus Christ. You can receive that as inheritance, as a gift. But God be thanked that though you were slaves to sin, yet you obeyed from the heart that form of doctrine to which you were delivered. And having been set free from sin, you became slaves of what? Righteousness. You're no longer slaves of sin. Thank you. That's good news. You are no longer slaves of sin. If you sin, you have this beautiful gift called repentance, which means change the way that you're thinking, close that chapter, and move on. A righteous man, though he falls down 7 times, he gets back up every single time. Number one, it is possible for believers to be in bondage. The enemy wasn't even concerned about you until you got free of putting you in bondage, because you already were in bondage. When you become free, he's very concerned about putting you into bondage. So Christians, be free indeed. Okay. Point number two, it is difficult to admit that you're in bondage. John 8:33, we heard that from them. Nobody wants to admit they're in bondage. But admission is the only thing that actually gets you free from bondage. Because until you recognize that you are in bondage, then you don't know the need for the person who is the one who will deliver you from bondage. Point number three is this, it's easy to get free. 1 John 3:8 says this, it's easy to get free. He who sins is of the devil. For the devil has sinned from the beginning. For this purpose, the Son of God was manifested. For what purpose? To destroy the works of the devil. What do you think that he did that? Pretty good. He came to do what you didn't have to do, to obtain what he did so that you could do what he did. You couldn't have destroyed the works of the devil by yourself, but he did it. And because he did it, and how did he do it? Complete dependence on his Father, under the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, under the power of the Holy Spirit, he destroyed the works of the enemy, and he said, oh, by the way, you do the same thing. The works of the enemy do not have to destroy you. Why? Because the same authority that Jesus walked in on the earth can be your authority if you will submit to his authority. Luke 10:17-20 says this, "Then the 70 returned with joy, saying, 'Lord, even the demons are subject to you, are to us in your name.'" He's going, duh. You guys just getting that now? That the demons are subject to my name? Are you kidding me? Go on. And he said to them, guys, do you realize I saw Satan fall like lightning from heaven? See, we got to see the same thing. We got to see the fact that that he's powerless, that he's toothless, that he has no dominion over you or authority over you. The reason he does is because of this thing called, you know, Here's the crux of it. Turn to Mark chapter 9, and I really do close with this. Mark chapter 9, I'm going to finish with this right now. I got to give you this. This is the clincher. This is what I struggle with. Maybe you struggle with it too. Mark chapter 9, beginning with 17. Then one of the crowd answered and said, "Teacher, I brought you my son who has a mute spirit, and wherever it seizes him, it throws him down. He foams at the mouth, he gnashes at his teeth, and he becomes rigid. So I spoke to your disciples and that they should cast it out." Watch this. "But they could not." Jesus' disciples, he mentored them, he pastored them, he directed them, and they could not. "He answered him and said, 'O faithless generation, how long shall I be with you, and how long should I bear with you?'" Watch this, what Jesus says, and he still says this today. "Bring him to me. Bring him to me." "Then they brought him to him, and when he saw him, immediately..." Did you hear that? "Immediately, the spirit that was within that young boy convulsed him, and he fell on the ground, and he wallowed, and he was foaming at the mouth." Now, I don't know what you would do if something like that happened in front of you. I just love what Jesus did. So he asked the father. We were in the emergency room last night. Kind of sounded like this. This young guy, he sounded like this. He goes, so he asked his father, "So how long has this been happening to your son?" Did you hear what the boy was doing? "Ah, the teeth, foaming the mouth, convulsing." And here's Jesus. He's really stressed about this. "So how long has this been happening to your son?" What will we be doing? "I speak to you, devil, come out of him. How long has this been going on?" See, I think we get all, yeah. See, people who walk by faith actually don't walk by stress. They walk in peace. Jesus was confident that that thing that was making all this noise wasn't really that noisy. Just a loud noise. You know that. And he said, I love the father's response. "Well, let me think back. From childhood and often, you know, often really he's been thrown around and he's been thrown into the fire. He's been thrown into the water, you know. But I love this statement that the father said. Looking at Jesus in this calm state, he said, "But if you can do anything, please have compassion on us and please help us." I love Jesus' response. He looks at him and he says, no, not if I can do anything. He said, "If you can believe, all things are possible to him who believes." And immediately, the father of the child cried out and said with tears, "Lord, I believe. Now help me with my unbelief." He goes on to say to his disciples privately, they said, how come we couldn't do this? And he said, "Because these ones only come out by prayer and fasting." I'd like to propose to you that Jesus, there are a lot of people don't want to make a doctrine out of things because they're afraid. Well, I don't like that methodology, Pastor Scott. I don't like that methodology. You know, I don't like this thing that you're doing with Sozo. I don't necessarily agree with counseling. I don't necessarily believe that you can, you know, wash, you know, the word or whatever it is. I just want to propose to you that, can I ask you something? Jesus said they only come out by prayer and fasting. If Jesus did these things as God, does God pray and fast? No. In his deity, is it necessary for God to pray and fast in order to deliver people? I'm going to tell you no. No, not in deity. What I'm saying is what Jesus did in the earth, he modeled something for us. Listen, guys, you want this demon to come out? Have a lifestyle of prayer and fasting. God in heaven, listen, when we get there, we're not going to be praying and fasting. We're not going to need spiritual gifts. We're not going to need fruit of the Spirit. It's all there already. We need those things here. Why? To bring heaven to earth. Jesus understood something. If I'm going to do what my Father wants me to do, then I've got to do some things that are needful in the earth to bring heaven to earth. And prayer and fasting was one of those things that Jesus had to do. He had a lifestyle of prayer and fasting, a lifestyle of spending time with his Father, a lifestyle of spending time in the Word. And the disciples wanted it by, oh, Jesus, just impart it to me. He demonstrated, he showed them, he taught them how to pray, all those things. Why? Because we have to learn things in the natural to allow the supernatural things to come. See, that's my problem right there. I have a lot of hope. When we were praying for that young boy, remember I told you that the leg was sticking out? I had a lot of hope. Lord, oh, I hope that you heal him. My hope would be that you heal him. I believe that you can, but I really don't believe that you're going to do it right now. That's just truthful. But I don't want to stay there. I'm crying out, man. I'm crying out. God, I believe, but help me. Help me with my unbelief. I want to believe better. I want to demonstrate better. I want to reveal your heart better. I want to see you come better. I don't want to stand in the way. I don't want my doubt or my fear or people's opinions to keep me from having you demonstrated by a touch that you touch somebody by my hand. Why can't? With that young boy at iMatter, when his leg got broke, if Jesus was there, we wouldn't have had to put him in the ambulance to send him to the hospital to have it confirmed. Jesus was just going, bing, bang, boom, get back out there and jump around. How do I know that? Because every time Jesus touched somebody, they went jumping and praising God. They all were in a mosh pit. I'm just saying, if he is in us, see, what we have is we got a whole bunch of people that believe in the historical Jesus. The disciples believed in the physical Jesus, but their lives weren't changed until they had an encounter with the risen Jesus. They weren't willing to die for him. They ran away from him until they had an encounter with the risen Jesus. See, when people have an encounter with the risen Jesus, their lives are changed forever. The Apostle Paul had an encounter with the risen Jesus, and Jesus didn't have a follow-up program. But Paul spent 14 years pursuing this Jesus, and then he became Jesus to a world. Follow me as I follow Christ. And I think he's looking for us to do that same thing. Do you realize something? That if we were all being Jesus, that whole field out there wouldn't contain all the people that would be here. Yes or no? If you're touching people's lives, here's my buddy. We spent some time at the fair together. We had a small group, connect group, together at the fair. Gave his life to the Lord there. Got himself all straight, moving, started reading. Had all these questions about the Word. All the people at the fair were looking around at us because we had Bibles out and we're asking questions. And we only had one connect group. What was my follow-up program with you? I didn't have one. Why are you here? Because you wanted to come. I didn't promise him anything. I didn't chase him. But I introduced him. He experienced something that he hadn't experienced before. But see, I can't give him what I don't have. That's why I want more of him, so I can give more of him away. I'm just going to be straight up with you.
Hey, man, would you please fill out a follow-up card and give me your another.
The world's tired of being a chase. They want something to chase after. And if we have something, if we're carrying something that they want, I promise you, they'll find you. We've only known each other a couple weeks, but I love this guy. I bet you I love him more than you do. You know why I know he's true about that? Because he's not just saying it, he actually spent time with him. You know why he knows that I love him? It's because I actually spent time with him. Best guy, I love people. You'll never have to say it if you do it. I kind of like you too. Oh, here we go. Father, I pray for our house. I pray for our church. I pray for this community. I pray for our culture. I pray that life would just manifest in us, that love would flow in us and through us, that a world won't be able to stand against that which is coming of your Spirit, God. This revival is nothing without love. In fact, how can there be a revival without love? So, Father, birth this baby. We've been carrying it. We've had the birth pains, but now birth it, God. Birth it, man. The world's going to see how beautiful you are because of that which you're going to birth through your people. We've liked and enjoyed being pregnant. We've liked pursuing crossing over. But we're ready. We're ready. We're ready for everything that's in the promised land. We know there's going to be giants. But you've given us a whole bunch of giant killers. And I know that once they hear about the one falling, that the other one's going to be very, very afraid. I pray for the cities, for the cultures, for the kingdoms that are of this world. We already declare that they are kingdoms of our God. How can the world that's looking for love repel love when it's given to them? And Father, I just pray that that overwhelming sense of your presence would not only undo us, but would impact every environment that we walk into. That people will feel value, they will feel purpose, they will feel hope, they will feel life because they've stepped into a new reality called your kingdom. And it's with that heart, it's with that spirit that we stand together right now. Let's all stand together. And we worship you one more time. If there are those of you who need to come and just confess, admit bondage, you want somebody to pray with you, this altar is going to be open. If you don't know Jesus and you want to know him, you want to step into the kingdom, come to the altar. You need a physical healing or a touch, come to the altar. You want to ask questions, come to the altar. There's things that you're concerned about, come to the altar. Spend some time here. We've got a half an hour. Spend some time here. Be loved on. Have an encounter with this Lord we talked about this morning. Find life and don't leave here without hope. I pray in Jesus' name. Kelly, will you lead us in worship? Let's worship him, man. Let's worship him.
Set a fire down in my soul that I can't contain, that I can't control. I want more of you, God. I want more of you. Set a fire down in my soul that I can't contain, that I can't control. I want more. I want more of you, God. It's you I choose, God. Set a fire down in my soul that I can't contain, that I can't control. I want more of you. Oh, I want more. 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 place that I'd rather be. No place that I'd rather be than here in your love, and set a fire down in my soul that I can't contain, that I can't control. I want more of you, God. I want more of you. Set a fire down in my soul that I can't contain, that I can't control. I want more of you, God. I want more of you. Oh, I want more of you, Lord. No more room for any other lovers. I want more of you, more of your spirit, more of your presence, God. I want more, more of you. So set a fire down in my soul that I can't contain, that I can't control. I want more of you, God. I want more of you. Set a fire down in my soul that I can't contain, that I can't control. I want more of you, God. I want more of you.
Altars are going to be open for a time of ministry. If you want ministry, feel free to come. If you want to stay and worship, feel free.